We have 48, which is really good for our. We're to Tallahassee. And of course, there's the time change, but we're not going to worry about the time change. I'm going to give you the times to be there in our regular times. You will have a chance to eat at the food court, and then afterwards, we're at quarter to. We will.
Quarter to nine, we came to Tallahassee.
We will. Quarter to 12, we will meet the guide, and then afterwards, he's going to try and take us to the new capital up on the 22nd floor. And you have a bird's eye view. And you have a bird's eye view of all Tallahassee. And then afterwards, you're going to visit a couple of the chambers there. And we will go to the mission, and that mission you'll have a lot of fun. It's a little bit of walking, but some of it you can sit too, and that's the San Luis mission. And if it sprinkles on us, we will go to this museum that he's already picked out, so we're looking forward to that. We should be back around 5 o'clock, give or take. Thank you. Sit back and relax.
This building, construction began in 1973, it finished in 1977. We opened for business March 31st, 1978. Now, I was born in 1978. Some of you probably think I'm a spring chicken. But this capital is actually a spring chicken as well, because it is the newest state capital in the United States of America. So Florida has the newest capital building in the nation. Something to be proud of as Floridians. Also, we have 25 stories here. We have 22 above ground and 3 below ground. All of you live in Florida, so you know what an architectural feat it is to have 3 stories below ground here. But actually, you're on the first level below ground now. You went inside of the chapel upstairs. In the public areas that we're going to be going through today, there's about 1,500 people at work in the building today. We have a committee week going on, so committee meetings are going on. During legislative session, that number will grow to about 6,000. So we'll have about 6,000 people working here every day, and then we will have another 2,000 spectators, reporters, lobbyists, people of that nature here. So getting in an elevator today, even though it did take a little bit of time to get down here, is much longer whenever we go into legislative session than it is today. And another thing that you'll see in the public areas is travertine marble. We imported about 1.5 acres of travertine marble from Italy, so that's what you see in all the public areas. Now, in the chapel that you saw upstairs, the chapel was constructed as a place for meditation, a place for prayer, something that's needed in government at times, definitely. And one unique thing about the chapel is that everything up there was from the state of Florida. The walls were made from coquina shells. They were cast over in the Jacksonville and St. Augustine area. The pulpit and the pit were made from Cory Keystone out of Florida City in the south part of the state. And the wood, actually, y'all might know this one, is from the Apalachicola River, so it's reclaimed cypress wood from the Apalachicola River. Even the glass balls around the window in the front are sea glass.
It was plaster last Wednesday.
Okay.
That's washed up along Florida's shoreline. We do a lot of things in the chapel. We do weddings today. They've actually done the Ash Wednesday ceremonies there. So we had a service this morning, and then they were doing some services out in the lobby, and they were doing private services in there, so that's one reason we came down here. Here we're in the cabinet room, so this is where the governor, it usually looks a lot better than this, because they usually have the nameplates up here, but they must be redoing. But we have the governor, we have the attorney general, the chief financial officer, and the commissioner of agriculture. That's all of the governor's executive cabinet. They meet here the second Tuesday of every month. So you can come here. It's free to the public. First come, first serve seating. And you can actually see what's going on the executive side of of the branch of government here in Florida. Our plan today is that we will leave here. We're going to go up to the 22nd floor. We'll be about 514 feet above sea level. Visibility is not great today, but we still should be able to see about 20 miles in all directions.
I was not about that. I was a girl.
Everybody uses
the
color orange.
I don't have one. Oh, sorry.
So it's a nice view up there. On a very clear day, you can actually see close to where the Georgia line is at and the Gulf of Mexico from this building. So it's a beautiful view.
22 stories high.
Once we leave there, we'll come down to the fifth floor, we'll go to the House of Representatives, as well as the Florida State Senate, and then we'll end our tour back on the plaza level, and you can look at the Halls of Fame, you can see where the governor's office is at, and the Florida State Seal. Do we have any questions? Yes, sir.
How many senators are there?
There's 40 senators in the state, sir. 40 senators, 120 representatives. Yes, ma'am. He does. Yeah, the governor's mansion. It's about 7 blocks north of here, so it's on the corner of Brevard and Duval Street. But he does. He lives
all the time. So
just trying to get a picture of the CN Tower.
What?
amphitheater. Back during that time, when both of these delegations rode up, there was a waterfall down there. And both of them saw it as a sign of this is where the Capitol should be. So the first Capitol, a log building, was built overlooking that waterfall. And now this is Tallahassee's latest revitalization project. It's called Cascade Park. So we are going to reinvent a man-made version of that same water. 30 degrees in 2 seconds, latitude and longitude. Now I will tell you, my favorite works of art,
one of his paintings, but it's beautiful, you know, like, this is the one I think is beautiful, stairs, the seal of the state of Florida.
Oh, yeah.
See, like, right here, look at this woman's hands.
Representatives in the state, so each one of these men or women will represent about 160,000 Floridians. So senators will tell you they do the same job with less people. Now, the chamber itself was renovated in 1999, so it's made to look a lot older than it actually is. The Senate has not been renovated yet, as I mentioned before. They have had the funds to renovate it, but they felt that with the economy being as poor as it is right now and people being unemployed in the state, that it would be in poor taste. So they use that money for other things besides renovation. And each mural represents a day in the life of Florida history, with this being the earliest, and then all the way around, the latest one is just below us. But these murals are extraordinary because every intricate detail of them is there for a very specific reason. There's nothing there just as scenery or just as happenstance. Everything that's in there is there for a very specific reason. You can actually look it up online, or they have information here that each of these things has about 40 or 45 hidden objects in it. And I'll give you one example, which is one of my favorites. On the third one over, we have Andrew Jackson. He's a Tennessee boy, by the way. I'm from Tennessee.
We kind of guessed that.
Oh, yeah. But he was the first territorial governor of Florida. Maybe it was also later on a president of the United States. But he is holding a flag, and there is a woman on the right-hand side of him, and that is the slave lady. And she has her hand over her heart, so she's pledging allegiance to the United States of America. But she has her back to the flag that Andrew Jackson's holding, because under that flag, slavery was allowed in the United States. So she has her back shunning that flag. But if you look at her, she is actually saluting the flag now at the front of the chamber. So she is saluting the current United States flag. So there's a lot of different, we have professors that come over from Florida State that teach entire lessons on each individual mural, so it's very interesting. Also in that teapot that you see in the front, it actually has a mirrored image. So if you were down there and you were able to look at it up close, it would look like you were looking in a mirror. And the mirrored image is the chamber itself. So these were painted on site to basically give them more appeal and more prestige. Now, the leader of this group is known as the Speaker of the House. Now, the new Speaker of the House that's coming in is Speaker Weatherford. The last Speaker of the House that we had was Dean Cannon. His portrait is over there. And the same portrait structure happens over here every 2 years. A new one is selected, and they move down. Now, the only big difference, operations-wise, between the Senate and the House is that representatives are elected to 2-year terms, while senators are elected to 4-year terms. Now, they can both serve 8 years consecutively before they have to leave office. But the big difference is that 2-year terms over here, and every 2 years, every seat is up for election. So there is a possibility that we would have completely all new representatives. Now, that has never happened, probably never happened, because generally we vote for incumbents. And we talked about seating before. The Speaker of the House determines the seat. But traditionally in this chamber, your incumbents, your guys and gals that have been here before and done it before, they would sit in the middle in the back. And the Democrat, you people, will sit in the back. So that is why his friend was put in the back. First of all, because he's new. So they will put the new representatives on the side.
That's where we was.
Lulu,
Lulu.
Say Lulu, Lulu, Lulu.
Lulu,
Lulu, Lulu, Lulu.
Lulu, 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 Lulu.
All together to the sky. Lulu, 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 Lulu. You sound like Appalachian. This is called Wash Away Dim when it gets here. But I'm picking this in the pot here.
You're going to burn it?
I am going to roast these leaves, and then I'm going to brew up an Appalachian black drink called Casina. Casina. And it was it's Yupon Holly. This is a very native bush. It grows up through the southeast. And the berries are poisonous. So we don't use the berries. We use the leaves. They are caffeinated. And the Appalachians would take the drink, and the women would prepare the casina. And if you're just walking up, this is Yupon Holly. We make the Appalachian black drink out of it, casina. We just use the leaves. They are caffeinated. But the Appalachian athletes, they come in the night before the ball game, and they say, "Where's our casina?" And the women tell them, "We have prepared it for you. Go take your seating. Start chugging." And they chug it hot all night. Lots of rituals involved with this ball game. They played it during the summer months. They chugged it hot. They howled like dogs. And then they pulled out their tobacco and smoked. They wanted to hallucinate. They did. To envision who's going to win this big game tomorrow. And then everyone goes out the next day excited. And they're waiting. Well, we have to play the game during the hottest time of the day. And they knew why. Because they played during the hottest time of the day because it brought them rain. I'm making on a big cookie sheet because I make a lot. Roast them about 10, 15 minutes. They'll be light brownish color, kind of crispy.
Yeah.
And I get a big pot of water boiling, and when they're cooled off, I dump them in the water and I boil mine a couple of hours. Okay. If you're making a small amount, probably 45 minutes an hour. Check the coloration. If it's light brownish, let it cook a little longer. If it gets darker, turn it off,
because
you can do it.
And tell her it tastes awful.
If you think it tastes awful, who's...
All of your guys in preparations, then none of them taste good.
Yeah, well, either you like it or you don't, and yeah. I've been serving it for 3-4 years now, and a lot of people do like it. There's a couple chairs here if you need it.
You need to spread out so you can hear. Not too far.
Thank you.
almost loose, and it's going to break off easy. At that point, if it's still glowing, I can put it in the nail header and break it off and finish it. That's a little cooler than I'd like it to be, so I'm just going to cool the tip one more time and heat that head a little more before I flatten it. And part of the reason I'm doing that is it's easier for me to flatten it, but also I'm saving wear and tear on my nail header. Because if I, over and over, put too cool of a piece of metal on there and hammer it flat, I'm wearing this quicker than if I use the properly heated metal. Because when that metal is properly heated, that's when it's soft, that I can manipulate it easy. So I put it in the nail header, break it off, put it over the hardy hole so the nail hangs down straight, and hammer the head flat. As soon as the head's flat, I'm essentially done. But usually I'll do four more hits, one from each direction, like this, and kind of make a faceted looking head. It's a little more decorative, it didn't take much more work, and so usually I'll do that. Now this nail is finished, but it's still hot. 1 second is not enough to cool it, but 3 seconds is. And so 3 seconds in the water, it's as cool as the water now. The nail is as cool as the water, and it shrunk a little, so I can just pop it out, and we can pass it around. And that's the nail making process. Thank you.
Oh, sí, usted sabe español.
Sí, sí.
Este sabe parlez-vous francés.
Oui, on parle français. ¿Todo bien?
¿Y los dos otros?
No, 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 es just nosotros.
¿Hablan español? Italiano. Italiano. English?
Yeah.
Oh, you should have said something. We'll be here all day. Welcome. My name is Don Diego de Florencia. I'm the merchant mariner here. And just to let you know, I'm not dressed as fancy as the rest of these Spanish folks because I've been gardening. Don't tell my mother.
Okay.
So, first things first, I want to tell you guys a little bit about this fort here. This is El Castillo de San Luis. Now, what that means is pretty much our stronghold, and it's also our barracks. Now, before we go inside, let me just point a few things outside. Now, these are our palisade walls, and in an event of a siege, we would all gather behind these walls, and it'd be everyone's duty to make sure that these walls stand. This is what really makes it a fort. Other than that, it's just a square house. I'll tell you honestly, it kind of looks like my grandma's house. So it's not that impressive. But these walls are what make it a fort. Now, as you look around, we have some of the cannons, of course, covered because it's going to rain fierce. But you'll see that there are bastions at the corners. Now, your bastions are, of course, used to pretty much clear all your blind sights. So if a group of Indians start hiding behind my wall, I don't want that. This wall is for me, not for them. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to order some soldiers with muskets out those bastions, and they'll clear these walls. Now, another thing to remember, this fort was fortified. It had so many cannons. In history, some would say that it was per every 1,000 soldiers, there was one cannon. We had dozens of cannons here. We didn't have that many soldiers. We really had more Appalachian militia. But without further ado, let's go in this fort, shall we? Now this right here is a 6-pound cannon. This is a real cannon that was taken out of a body of water out here somewhere near St. Mark's. This is a real Spanish cannon. If you notice, it's marked and everything. They know how many times it fired and everything. This is a real 6-pound cannon, and in an event, all these cannons would have been everywhere. You would have had one at every bastion. You would have had one at the front door, I like to call the welcome mat. You would have had 4 up top, 2 mortars, and 2 swivel guns. Now, what are swivel guns? They're pretty much giant muskets. And what's a mortar? It's a small cannon, and it's used to lob weapons over. There really weren't. And historically recorded, there were anywhere from 12 to 50. So, with that being said, 12 to 50, why so many cannons with that little of soldiers? Well, there was actually a huge militia, and they ranged in the thousands. There were a few hundred families that lived in this area alone, not to mention the surrounding villages. So they all...
Okay, this is your and this is the friary. This is the friary and the area that you're specifically in.
now is the chapel. In the chapel, that's where the young Appalachian and Spanish boys and girls get their religious education. They're coming here every day for their religious instruction, learning those prayers that they have to know. And it's a lot of them. So it's repetition to keep going over and over and over those prayers. Often taught by the Alfaque, which is the Appalachian interpreter, because there are just two Franciscan friars here, and they have about 1,500 people in the community. So they are doing various different chores and tasks during their day. So part of that work is left to an Alfaque or Appalachian to take on the instruction of the young boys and girls, both Spanish and Appalachian. Also in here is where your choir is doing their practicing. The choir loft up there is very similar to the choir loft next door, except it's a very smaller location over here, as the boys that are in the choir.
Thank you.
Yeah, that right there is your infirmary, and then you have your living quarters in the back. As they practice their chanting. And the hand on the wall there, that's called your Budonian hand. Each part of the hand is divided up into different notes. You simply just point to different parts of the hand, chant the different notes, and then that's how the boys first learn the music. And then as they get more comfortable with it, then you can put the music on the music stand there, and they just stand in a semicircle around the music stand to continue their musical education. And then about a year or more, they're ready to go over and sing in the church for mass or weddings or funerals or whatever the occasion happens to be. And today is the day on the church calendar. Ash Wednesday begins the season of Lent, which is 40 days leading up to Easter, which means a time of fast and abstinence and prayer and reflection. A time of no meat for 40 days. It's only until you get to Easter that you can eat meat again. Eggs too are, think of a vegetarian diet, no cheese, no dairy products that you're consuming. And definitely a time of more prayer, more reflection, and there are certain days that you can't do work during Lent, because you'll be supposed to be focusing on that, reflection. And oftentimes, punishment is a form of that, as you're whipping yourself, of atoning for those sins that you're confessing in the church. It's a big time of confession, because you're getting yourself ready for Easter. It's the one time a year that the congregation's allowed to take communion. So you want to get yourself ready. Part of that is doing penance, going to confession, saying your prayers, going to church, doing all those things you're supposed to be doing. So when you reach the Easter season, you're ready to participate in the whole of the Easter Mass and everything else. So I don't know if you have any questions. I know I made it short because we're running out of time, but if anybody has any questions on the way out,
well, here we are at the end of the day. You've had a good trip. Saw the mission, saw the
Mission San Luis.
Mission San Luis. Cool.